This is a 2020 Toyota CHR, and it's weird. It's a hatchback or a crossover, depending on your point of view, but regardless of how you classify it, it's peculiar, and it fits into an odd place in Toyota's lineup, and I like it. And today, I'm going to review this CHR and explain why. First, a little background. Now, regardless of whether you call it a hatchback or a crossover, the CHR is definitely a compact car. It's only 172 inches long, which makes it about a foot shorter in length than a Toyota Corolla. As for the name, CHR stands for Compact High Rider or Coupe High Rider, depending on who you believe. And that high riding is part of the reason why this thing is so quirky. You see, the CHR is only offered with a 144 horsepower four-cylinder engine and front-wheel drive. Now, to me, that means it isn't a crossover. It can't be. Nothing is really a crossover or an SUV unless it's offered with all-wheel drive. So that makes it a hatchback. But then there's that whole high riding thing. This is pretty tall. In fact, it's only 2 inches shorter in height than a Porsche Macan, which makes it seem like a crossover. So what exactly is it? I'm not sure. But really, it doesn't matter what class the CHR fits into. I just like the fact that it's weird. So many car enthusiasts go on and on about how all modern cars are boring and they all look the same and there are no differences anymore. Well, the CHR is certainly different. And I'm thrilled that it came from Toyota, which has been known to primarily play it safe rather than experiment with outside-the-box stuff like the CHR. If you like it too, the CHR is surprisingly affordable and has a starting price of around $22,000, and even if you get every single option and feature, you'll struggle to break 30 grand. So today, I'm going to take you on a tour of the CHR, and I'm going to show you around this weird, affordable, SUV, crossovery hatchback thing, and I'm going to show you all of its interesting quirks and features. Then I'm going to get it out on the road and drive it, and then I'm going to give the CHR a Doug score. All right, I'm gonna start the quirks and features of the CHR with some of its weirdnesses, and that means discussing the door situation. I've had several people talk to me about the CHR, shocked that Toyota would make a vehicle like this with only two doors, and you can see two obvious front doors here. So this is a two-door tall hatchback crossover thing. What a bizarre segment to be in. But the truth is that the CHR is not merely a two-door vehicle. It has rear doors. It's just that the back door handles are kind of concealed within the roof and this window line area. The door handles are up here. And so the result is that it looks like a coupe, and that's kind of the intent. It's supposed to be sort of a sportier coupe-looking crossover-y hatchback thing, but that's only because they've hidden the back door handles. If you want to access the rear seats, it's just like every other vehicle with back doors, but the handle is up here, so it's pretty simple once you realize they're there. But yes, at first glance, this does look like a two-door vehicle, but it isn't. And next up, another weirdness of the CHR is undoubtedly its color options. You can see this one is blue with a black roof, but there are many different colors available. Some are full color, not two-tone like this one, but you can also get some two-tones with some roof colors that don't really match all that well with the body color. There's some very strange CHR colors out there that they offer. In fact, blue and black is pretty tame in comparison with some other ones. And next up, we move inside the CHR, which has quite a few interior temps to make it weird and cool. Except that Toyota doesn't really do weird and cool, so most of them kind of fall flat. It's like when your parents tried to use cool, hip, teenager lingo to communicate with you a little better, and it just sounds weird. That's how I feel about the interior in this car. I'll give you a few examples. One is undoubtedly on the headliner. You have these weird patterns, these diamond shapes kind of pushed into the headliner coming out from the sun visor and then fading as they go back. Not exactly sure what that's trying to be, but it's intending to make the interior more hip and weird. And next up, for another one, go to the door panel, and you can see there's a rather unorthodox design for some of it. You have this interesting kind of square triangle pattern that goes throughout the door panel. Again, an attempt to make it more hip and cool and interesting in here. And also on the door panel, check out the speaker cover. You don't get just a regular speaker cover, no, no. You get, like, some diamonds to accentuate this car's quirkiness. Oh, we don't have just regular speakers in here. We got diamonds. We're fun, see? We have fun diamonds, yeah! And speaking of diamonds, go back to the ceiling. You can see another place where Toyota tried to inject some fun into this car, and that would be the dome light switches, which are in kind of a diamond pattern, and then the lights themselves have this V shape, and it's all way more interesting than what you get in a boring regular Toyota. That's how you add fun to an interior. You make the dome light controls a slightly different shape. Yeah, Toyota! And for another example of this interior fun, look no further than the door sills. Open the doors and you can see there's this pattern on the door sills. Almost looks like a tire tread type pattern. Same deal with the back door. You open up the back door and there's a little bit of this pattern on the smaller door sill back there. And you also have this pattern next to the rear seats, kind of next to the seat back. There it is again. So we've got some patterns going on in the door sill area. We're cool, yeah! Really, when you look at all that stuff, it does seem like Toyota's a parent who's trying to be cool and connect with their kid, and they're like, well, I want to be cool, but what do kids find cool these days? Oh, I've got it! Kids like patterns, don't they? And so that's about as weird and cool as Toyota can possibly get. At the end of the day, they're still Toyota. They don't do weird, but apparently they do patterns. With that said, beyond all the patterns, there are some weird and notable quirks and features in here. I want to start with the cup holders. Now, the front cup holder in the center console is normal, nothing unusual about it except for maybe its shape. The rear cup holder has kind of a strange quirk to it. If you look in, you can see there's this plastic panel with two holes, and if you pull it out, it says S size, and it shows arrows and a letter M. If you flip over this panel, you can see it's oriented so that if you put it back in, it will allow for a larger drink to fit in place, or an M, or medium drink, which is a pretty cool idea. And then on the medium side of this panel, you can see it tells you that if you remove the panel entirely, then you can fit a large drink. So this little panel allows you to get small, medium, or large size drinks into this cup holder just based on how the panel is oriented. That is kind of a cool idea. And next up, here's another cool idea. In the center control stack, next to the infotainment display, you have these little red lights that light up that have a seat belt on them. Those are for the rear seats, and they let you know if your rear seat passengers are buckled in. Right now they're all red because none of the rear seat belts are buckled. This is a cool idea because if you load your kids into the car, you don't have to turn around and try to figure out if they've all buckled their seat belts. It can be hard to tell. Just look right here on this little display and it'll tell for you. That is a neat feature, and it's well placed so that it's convenient and easy to just have a look at and see if your kids are buckled in. And next up, another neat feature in here is on the climate controls. The controls are all pretty standard, except if you look in the upper right, you can see there's a button marked Eco. Now, a lot of cars have an Eco driving mode, but this has an Eco mode specifically for the climate controls. My assumption is it operates them in a more economical way and doesn't use as much fuel and energy in the process. That is a cool idea for people who are willing to make the trade-off of not having air blowing on them at the full possible amount so they can save a little fuel. More climate control systems should probably have an eco mode. And next up, another interesting quirk in this interior. The parking brake in this car is electronic, like it is in most new cars, and it's operated with a little switch in the center console. The thing I like here is that Toyota has designed a finger hole to make it easier to use the switch. You can see right in front of the parking brake switch, you just insert your finger into this little plastic hole for it. And next up, another interesting operation in here is the glove box, which is very much on the lower side of the dashboard, completely hidden from view over on the passenger side. But there is a glove box, and to open it, you don't use your standard glove box latch. Instead, you push on this little release and that opens it up. Kind of notable because it's a little bit of an unusual glove box situation. And next up, we move on to the infotainment system, which is, of course, this big screen in the center. Now, I recently showed you this system in the new Toyota Avalon, and I told you it was a little bit laggy. That's still true in this vehicle. You can see when you press something, it just doesn't happen as instantaneously as it does in a lot of cars, which have gotten their infotainment systems to operate like smartphones with immediate touch and immediate response the moment you tap your finger on the screen. Toyota's just isn't quite like that, and it's definitely a little bit behind the industry in terms of its responsiveness to when you tap it. One other item worth pointing out in this infotainment system, you have these four buttons over on the left that bring you to various different areas in the system. The bottom one is map. In this vehicle, you press map and it doesn't work. This car doesn't have a navigation system. The software isn't included, so the map button does nothing. So one of your four main infotainment system controls simply has no function in this vehicle. This highlights the danger of using kind of a one-size-fits-all infotainment system, because in some vehicles, it kind of looks stupid when a major button doesn't work. With that said, one interesting item I found in the infotainment system that I really like is something called driver setting. You go into settings, you tap on this, and apparently you can configure it so that when your Bluetooth phone is connected, your infotainment preferences will also be remembered. So instead of having like a physical button for your memory settings, it just automatically remembers whenever you get into the car and you have your phone set. That is a really cool idea. I wish more cars would have it. And next up, another notable item in here, just like in the new Avalon I recently reviewed, the CHR has a gauge cluster animation. When you turn it on, you press the starter button, and then this happens on the screen, gives you a silhouette of the CHR, reminding you what you're driving. The other interesting item in that gauge cluster, far more unusual than the animation, you have a G meter in here. It will actually measure your G forces. Now, I see this in performance cars. You have a G meter in your Shelby Mustang or your Hellcat, so you can see exactly how many G's you're pulling when you go fast around a sharp corner. Wasn't expecting to see it in the Toyota CHR hatchback crossovery thing, but it's there, so you can measure your G's. And next up, we move into the back seat in the CHR, where there are a couple of interesting items worth noting. One is that it's actually surprisingly roomy back here, even for legroom. I don't have a ton of space with the passenger seat where I would be sitting, but I do have enough space. My knees are right up against it, but I can sit back here in relative comfort, which is surprising given that this is a pretty small vehicle. And it's the same story with headroom. You wouldn't expect it, but the CHR actually has pretty good headroom. I can sit upright back here, and my head is only just barely maybe tapping the ceiling with my hair. There's actually a reasonably decent amount of space in here given the CHR's size. Now, the headroom thing is an interesting trick of this car's design. When you look at it from the outside, you would think there is no rear headroom because the roof line kind of tapers off and it looks like a coupe, and it probably robs the rear seat passengers of all comfortable space. But that's not actually what happens. You can see that the top of the window line is actually what tapers off, giving it that coupe appearance, but the roof line actually stays pretty flat throughout the entire vehicle, which provides for a decent amount of headroom. So it's actually just a trick of the CHR's exterior styling. It looks like it has that slopey roof coupe design, but it actually preserves rear seat headroom and makes it reasonably comfortable back here. With that said, one complaint I do have is that it feels a little claustrophobic. The bottom of the window line kind of comes up, as you can see, and as a result, you're sitting here with a panel directly next to your face rather than a window like you're used to in a backseat of most cars, and so you kind of feel like you're sitting in a box and it's closing in around you, and it does feel a little bit claustrophobic for that reason back here. But in terms of actual interior room, not a problem. And by the way, speaking of the rear seats, it's worth noting that they do fold down. You can see you pull this little latch on the side of the seat, it folds down, and they fold in sort of a split configuration, so you don't have to have the whole seat folded at once, but you can if you want. And by the way, speaking of the cargo area in the CHR, it is pretty much normal. You open up the tailgate, the cargo area looks like you'd expect from a little hatchback crossover thing. Nothing weird, nothing unusual, nothing special in here. Although it is worth noting that there's one interesting item on the tailgate, and that would be instructions on how to close it. You don't just insert your hand into the tailgate closer handle. Instead, it shows you in this diagram, you insert your hand upside down, and then you can pull it closed. So it lets you know how to do it for maximum tailgate closing effectiveness. Thank you, CHR. And finally, we move on to the outside of the CHR. I want to go over the interesting quirks and features out here, starting with the styling. And to me, the most notable feature of the styling are these creases that go down the side of the car, kind of from the front fender all the way down the side, then into the back fender again. This gives this thing a very distinctive look. Whether you like it or not, it certainly doesn't really resemble anything else on the road, especially at this price point or in this class. Another interesting exterior item is this giant rear spoiler. This thing is massively oversized for basically any car, but it's got a rear spoiler and a G-force meter for all of your sporty driving needs with 144 horsepower. Next up, two more notable CHR exterior items, both up front. One is the front turn signal, which you can see is this large LED strip that goes all the way from the front to the side of the car. This is like 2.5 feet of front turn signal. No one will ever be confused about what direction you're turning if you have a CHR. Also on the front, there's this little fog light, just a traditional circular fog light below the regular headlight assembly, kind of stuck in between all of the folds and creases in the front of the CHR. Never really noticed this before, but you can turn it on and see better in the fog, I guess. And finally, the last exterior item I want to cover with the CHR in terms of design and styling is my own opinion of how this car looks. And frankly, I like it. I actually really like how distinctive and unusual and weird and quirky that it is. A lot of car enthusiasts complain about this car. They say it's ugly, it's too strange, why did they make it? These are the exact same people who complain, all new cars look the same, and then Toyota comes out with something different, and then they say, that's ugly! And then you wonder why automakers don't take more risks. Frankly, I'm glad they took this risk. It's weird, it's quirky, but in a good way. And based on how many of these I see driving around, I think most people agree with me. And finally, we move under the hood in the CHR, and you can see the engine. Like I mentioned, this is a four-cylinder, 144 horsepower. Nothing weird or crazy or particularly unusual here. There's no high-performance version of the CHR. Here in North America, this is the only engine we get with this vehicle. And so, those are the quirks and features of the 2020 Toyota CHR. Now it's time to get it out on the road and see how it drives. All right, driving the CHR. Now I gotta say, on the road, this doesn't behave that differently from a lot of other cars of its ilk. But there are some cool things to it. One is, in my mind, this is a hatchback. I really think a car can't be a crossover without having all-wheel drive. So I think this is like a Kia Soul competitor, that sort of thing. And for a hatchback, it has kind of a cool benefit, which is that it's tall. You can sit up higher. You can have almost SUV-type seating position, but you're in a hatchback. Now, this is a kind of cool car, and it's kind of interesting and weird and special in a lot of ways. It's definitely more exciting than like a typical car, Volkswagen Golf or a Corolla hatchback or sort of the boring Prius, the boring kind of cars that everybody has in this world. And that's one of the reasons I like it. I like that they've done this and I like that they've gone there. Now, one cool thing is a lot of cars that are weird or interesting, you got to put up with a lot of weird stuff. In this car, it's pretty straightforward Toyota in the interior. Now, personally, I wish it was less straightforward Toyota. I wish it was more weird, more quirky, more interesting. But I suspect that most actual people, if you want to make the car have a mainstream appeal, they want just normal stuff, but in kind of a quirky wrapper, and that's what this car is. As for the driving experience, some pros and cons. It's not very fast, not very fun to drive, not particularly engaging, steering not great. It drives like kind of a tall, kind of cheap hatchback. That's basically the reality of it. You're not going to be surprised or enamored or really excited by this, and it has just enough power to really get it to do what it has to do, but not, you know, fun or an exciting amount. On the highway, there's a little bit more tire noise than I expected and kind of road noise. There's not a lot of wind noise, not really any, actually. It feels pretty good in that capacity, but tire noise and kind of noise from vehicles around you and that sort of thing is
there, as you'd expect for a vehicle that is price ranges between $22,000 and $30,000. Now, one thing I will say, I am really disappointed by Toyota's decision not to give this vehicle all-wheel drive here in North America. There are parts of the country that it doesn't matter, like Southern California, where I am, Florida, Arizona, Texas, places like that, but a huge portion of the country wants all-wheel drive, feels that they need all-wheel drive, and it would be such an easy thing because this car is sold with all-wheel drive in other markets. So why not just bring the all-wheel drive one here? It seems like such an obvious decision, and it would account for more sales for a vehicle that already exists, already through regulations. And it's a very questionable decision by Toyota. Overall, I think the real target market for this car is not necessarily people who are looking to have fun in a car, but people who want a car that is kind of fun. In other words, like a car that's fun looking, quirky, kind of fits a quirky personality, but maybe doesn't involve a crazy driving experience or a fuel economy penalty or that sort of thing. And this is exactly that. It gives you a quirky automotive experience without doing anything crazy to any other aspect of it.
And so that's the 2020 Toyota CHR. This thing is weird, but in a good way. And I know a lot of car enthusiasts will complain that it's ugly or it's slow or weird or whatever, but I like when car brands go outside the norm and think a little differently. It doesn't really matter whether it's an SUV or a crossover or a hatchback, the CHR is quirky in the best way possible. And now it's time to give it a Doug score.
Starting with the weekend categories and styling, I like the CHR, but it's not beautiful, just interesting and quirky, and it's also opinion splitting, so it gets a 5 out of 10. Acceleration, it's quite slow. 0 to 60 is around 10 seconds. It could definitely use more power, and it gets a 1 out of 10. Handling is fine, normal for a car like this, and it gets a 3 out of 10. Fun factor is okay. It's slow and not particularly engaging, but there's some fun in its quirky styling and image, and it gets a 2 out of 10. Finally, cool factor, and it's sort of cool, certainly cooler than most normal cars and four-cylinder Toyotas, and it gets a 3 out of 10. For a total weekend score of 14 out of 50. Next up are the daily categories and features. It's fine, about what you'd expect for the price point, and it gets a 6 out of 10. Comfort, same deal, about what you'd expect, and it gets a 6 out of 10. Quality is fine, the materials are average, but Toyota's reputation for reliability earns it a 7 out of 10. Practicality is good, but not great. The rear seat room is fine, but cargo capacity is relatively low thanks to the sloped roofline and small size, and it gets a 7 out of 10. Finally, value, and I think these are good values. Under 30 grand for the nicest one with some decent tech, or low 20s for a base model, it's a nice price point, and it gets a 7 out of 10 for a total daily score of 33 out of 50. Add it up, and the Doug score is 47 out of 100, which places the CHR here against other rivals I've tested. The CHR ties the RAV4, although the CHR does way better in the weekend categories and worse in the daily scores, as you might expect. But the CHR lags behind what I consider to be its chief rival, the Kia Soul. The Soul has more available power, better tech, and better practicality. The CHR is good, but I think the Kia is simply the better overall package.